In 2019, Tiger Global invested $100 million in Ninjacart. This was the largest solo bet of the firm ever in an Indian startup. And it's not the size of the deal that was interesting, it is the sector in which they invested in. Ninjacart was a B2B Agritech startup, and at the time, Agritech wasn't a very attractive sector for big VC firms in India. It was fragmented, complex to make sense, and most importantly, there was no clear growth plan. But this deal by Tiger Global alone put Agritech in the center of India's startup ecosystem. In the next few years, the number of Agritech startups in India exploded, and with this, the VC funding too increased exponentially. From a mere $60 million in funding in 2017, the funding in the Agritech sector increased to $895 million by 2021, a 1500% increase in just 4 years. For a while, it looked like that the influx of VC money would change the face of India's agricultural sector, but sadly, most of what was promised did not happen. The funding in the sector has now dried out, and one after the other, many leading agritech startups have shut down. 2024, in fact, was the worst year for the Indian agritech sector in the last 7 years, and investors are hesitant to put any more money in the sector. So what really happened? What got investors excited into the sector in the first place? And then how did the bubble burst? And what was government's role in it? Let's understand all this in this video. India is often called an agricultural country. Close to 50% of our workforce is employed in the sector, and yet it contributes only 18% to the country's GDP. This shows how inefficient agriculture in India is. And let me give you some more eye-opening contrast. This is the number of people employed in agriculture versus its contribution to GDP. And meanwhile, less than 0.5% of India's population works in IT, but this sector contributes 7.5% to GDP. Now let's compare this data with a different country, say the US. In the US, 10.4% of their population is involved in agriculture, and the sector still contributes 5.5% of their GDP, much better than India. And this was in percentage terms. If we take actual numbers, then this difference become even more contrasting. 50% of India's population is around 700 million people, and 18% of our GDP is $700 billion. So basically, an average Indian person who is employed in the agriculture sector creates $1,000 worth of GDP in 1 year. In the US, 10.4% of the population is 34 million people, and they generate 5.5% of their GDP, which is $1.6 trillion. So an average US person who is employed in the agriculture sector creates $47,000 worth of GDP in 1 year. This is a massive difference. Which brings up the question, why is this the case? Why are Indian farmers so inefficient? The answer to this is very complex, but we can safely say that following are the three main problems for Indian farmers. First one is small and fragmented land holdings. Then there is low income and high debt. And finally, the dependence on traditional farming methods. And let me explain each of these in detail. Most Indian farmers, almost 70%, are classified as marginal farmers, which means they own less than 1 hectare of land. And to give you an idea of scale, this is how 1 hectare looks like on a cricket field. This may seem substantial to you, but it's barely enough for farmers to sustain themselves. Let me show you how. Imagine you're a farmer with 1 hectare of land. You grow rice during the kharif season and wheat during the rabi season, something most farmers do to maximize their income. And if you do this, in an ideal year, this is how your yield will look like. Approximately 3000 kg per hectare of rice and 5000 kg per hectare of wheat. And now let's say you sell these. Government declared MSP for both rice and wheat is 2300 rupees per quintal. And so, at the end of the year, your total income would be 1.84 lakh. And if you deduct expenses like seeds, fertilizers, irrigation, and labor, your profit would only be around 1.1 lakh rupees. That's only about 9,000 rupees per month to support your entire family. And this number, by the way, is very close to the estimated monthly income of an Indian farmer. And this leads to the second problem we talked about, and that is low income and high debt. I mentioned that an average farmer makes around 9 to 10,000 rupees per month, and this is barely enough to run a family. And in case the farmer needs money for big expenses like their kid's wedding, they're forced to take a debt. And this is where it gets worse. Less than 20% of farmers in India have access to formal loans from a bank. The remaining 80% rely on informal lenders who charge very high interest rates. And this could range from 20% to as high as 50% per annum. This over multiple years makes it very difficult for the farmers to pay back. And as a result of this, 50% of Indian farmers today are in debt. And one farmer dies by suicide every year. are due to financial distress. And the issue of low income leads us to the third problem we talked about, and that is dependence on old methods of farming. A big portion of Indian agriculture still relies on age-old farming methods. For example, many farmers depend on rain-fed irrigation, and a single drought or unseasonal rainfall can wipe out an entire harvest. And these issues can be solved by modern techniques like precision farming, IoT-enabled tools, and drones, but these methods are very expensive. But because of low and unpredictable income, most farmers can't even think of upgrading their methods. 2019 was a pivotal moment for Indian agri-tech startups, and there was one event that was largely responsible for this. Ninjacart, which is an agri-tech startup working on fresh food supply chain, raised a $100 million funding round from Tiger Global. This was the largest single investment in the sector, and it also marked the entry of a major VC player into agri-tech. This signaled to the industry that agri-tech is no more a niche space, but a viable investment opportunity. And around the same time, EY published a report on Indian agri-tech, and it projected the sector to grow 100 times in just 5 years. From an annual turnover of around $200 million, it was projected to reach $24 billion by 2025. This was a big opportunity, and both VCs and founders jumped on it. In terms of the number of startups, it increased from around 250 in 2017 to 3,000 in 2023. And these startups sold a very attractive dream about India's agri-tech space. Firstly, they promised to increase income for farmers. Next was use of advanced equipment and technology on farms. And finally, they promised to streamline supply chains and eliminate inefficiencies like middlemen. According to a report, there could be as many as 11 middlemen between a farmer and the final consumer. And these middlemen erode most of the value that should rightly belong to the farmer. And by connecting farmers directly to end users such as retailers, processors, and hotels, these startups aim to restore this lost value to the farmer and hence increase their income. Investors loved this dream, and the funding in agri-tech startups soared after this optimism was further fueled by the Indian government when it introduced three farm laws in 2020.
India's parliament has passed the two of the three agriculture-related bills.
It's a big boost to the government for the passage of the farm reform in Rajya Sabha.
Bills on agriculture reforms are set to become law after being passed by the Rajya Sabha.
These laws deregulated the traditional way of selling the produce in APMC mandis and allowed the farmers to sell wherever they found better prices. Next, it introduced the concept of contract farming, where farmers could sign agreements with buyers before planting crops. And it was done to reduce the risk of market fluctuations and guarantee a prefixed price for the produce. And finally, it allowed private players to set up infrastructure, such as cold storage and warehouses, to store essential commodities in big quantities. These laws were later repealed by the government because of massive protests. But at the time, these were seen as very transformative for agriculture sector, and everyone believed that they will create a more favorable environment for these startups to operate in. And so, with the help of government regulations and investors' money, agri-tech startups envisioned a modernized agriculture sector, where farmers will get access to technology, things like IoT devices to monitor their crops, and mobile app to track every data. Next was access to credit. Farmers could avail of easy loans at decent interest rates and then repay it in easy installments. And finally, these startups promised to remove middlemen so that the farmer could get higher prices for their produce. This dream resonated with investors, government bodies, and even farmers who were looking for a way out of their miserable conditions. The dream of transforming India's agriculture through startups was very ambitious. But things did not turn out as hoped. To begin with, the very reforms that were meant to support agri-tech startups, the three farm laws, were repealed within a year of their introduction. The government failed to make the farmers understand their benefits, and the protests against them were so strong that the government had to take them back. This was a massive setback for agri-tech startups, as they were relying on these reforms to help them in their vision. Next big challenge for the startups were the deep-rooted structural issues. And these were so deep-rooted that the startups failed to comprehend them. And let me explain these one by one with examples. First is the role of middlemen. Startups had the vision of eliminating middlemen to connect farmers directly with end users. However, what these startups failed to understand was that these middlemen are more than just intermediaries. They play a critical role in financing, logistics, and maintaining trust within the farming community. Let's take the example of Grinnick to explain this point. Grinnick was an agri-tech startup focused on banana trading, and they aim to cut out middlemen and create a direct link between farmers and buyers. The startup, however, soon realized how difficult it was to do this. To begin with, they struggled to replace the trust and financial safety offered by middlemen. See, these middlemen do crucial things like financing the entire farming cycle. So what they would do is, even before a farmer sows the crop, these middlemen give them a small advance amount. And once the crop is ready, they buy it from the farmer at a lower than a market price. And this is good for both farmers and middlemen, since farmers get an assured income for their crops and middlemen get the produce at lower than the market price. Here is what Greenix co-founder Praveen Jacob Varkis had to say about this. Middlemen know everything about farmers and the harvest cycle, and farmers are scared to give produce to anyone else because middlemen often finance the entire farming activity. As a result of this, Greenix ended up working with the very middlemen it sought to eliminate, which is very ironic. And without directly connecting with farmers, Greenix failed to deliver the cost savings and higher profits it had promised. And because of this, it shut down last September. Now let's come to the second promise these startups made, and that was to bring technology like IoT devices to the farmers. And this claim too has fallen flat. And let me give you an example of IntelloLabs to explain this. The idea of IntelloLabs was, you can click a picture of the produce like fruits and vegetables and then upload it on the company's app. Its algorithm would then use AI and image analytics and will tell you whether the produce was damaged, raw or ready to consume. Great idea, right? Well, it seems like they could not monetize this idea. The farmers were not willing to pay for these services, and the reason is simple. They have no money to spend. If you're earning only 10,000 rupees a month, how will you pay for these devices? Then there were startups who provide crucial data to farmers regarding crop health, rainfall, etc. But in many cases, the farmers didn't know what to do with the data these companies were providing. The data that they gave apparently was very fragmented and it was of no use to the farmers. And hence, farmers eventually stopped using them. And now, the final reason why these startups failed is the dirty VC game. See, VCs work on a very simple philosophy. If they're putting $1 million into a startup, they would want a 50 million or 100 million exit out of it. And for that to happen, the startup has to grow very, very fast. So these VCs tried using the same strategy into agritech startups, but this philosophy did not work. Let me give you an example of Resha Mandi to explain this point. Resha Mandi was once a rising star in the agritech sector. It had raised $50 million to digitize India's silk supply chain. However, the company collapsed within just 3 years due to unsustainable practices. And the main reason was companies' burn and grow model. They thought that they could use VC money to grow fast and then later focus on profits. So for example, the company paid farmers 450 rupees per kg for cocoons when the market price was just 350 to 400 rupees. And then it sold them at discounts to retailers. Similarly, they bought silk yarn at 4300 rupees per kg and sold it below the market rate of 4000 rupees. According to a former employee, we often asked why we were not taking advances from buyers. The answer we got was, this is how startups work. We have to disrupt the market. And this approach led to consistent cash crunches in the company, and it forced them to depend heavily on loans. In its pursuit of rapid growth, Resha Mandi pivoted to multiple ventures that stretched its resources and focus, and then none of which succeeded. The company expanded from silk to other fibers like cotton and jute, ventured into new businesses such as silkworm waste trading, and launched subsidiaries like Shapoz Farm, Shapoz Lifestyle, and Resha Mudra Finance. In FY20 alone, Resha Mandi spent 200 crore rupees on these subsidiaries, further worsening its cash flow issues. And once the funding winter hit in 2023, Resha Mandi's financial condition was so bad that it could not raise further funds and shut down. Now, similar to Resha Mandi, even we face situations where we have a financial crunch. Now, for most people, we either need to take a personal loan where interest rates are crazy high or need to liquidate our stock or mutual fund investments, which again, we don't want to do as we lose out on compounded growth part and also pay the capital gain tax of up to 35%. And this is where Yenmo comes to help you. Yenmo is a YC-backed startup that provides loans against stock and mutual fund investments, and that too at an attractive interest rate of just 10.5%. So no liquidation of your investment and also extremely low interest rates. The best feature of this product is that you only have to pay interest every month on the amount you have used. And you can pay the principal amount anytime during the loan tenure without any pre-closure charges. And this helps you manage your cash flow more effectively, letting you pay down the principal when you have excess cash, and in other months you can simply pay the interest on the amount you have used. So next time you're in need of some urgent cash, think about Yenmo. I'll provide their link in the description and the pinned comment. And thanks Yenmo for sponsoring this video. The main thing this case study teaches us is just the entry of private players and money can't solve the agriculture crisis in the country. There are many things that need to be done, but the most important of which is to take the majority of people out of farming. Remember I mentioned that almost 50% of our population is dependent on farming? Well, we need to bring that number to less than 10%. 5% the way it's in other developed countries. And for startups, the VC-funded model of burn and grow won't work in this sector. And we need sustainable and long-term solutions to come out. In the end, I want to ask you, what do you think can be done to solve India's agriculture crisis? And how do you think startups can help in that? Share your thoughts in the comments, and I'll see you in the next one.